Throughout the years at Arctic Circle assemblies and forums, a recurrent theme has been the Arctic model of collaboration, of course. But an aspect of it has also been to introduce the Arctic model of collaboration to the Third Pole region. The Third Pole region encompasses the Himalayan mountain range and other mountain ranges surrounding the Tibetan Plateau. One aspect of the Arctic model of collaboration since the 1980s, before the, even the establishment of the Arctic Council, has been international collaboration on scientific research. And another aspect of it has been the way in which the relationship between science and politics is designed and structured within the Arctic Council framework. And earlier this year, the Arctic Circle launched the Third Pole Process. And the Third Pole Process aims to take this engagement beyond efforts to only introduce the scientific collaboration and to help facilitate dialogue on the relationship between science and politics in the Third Pole region. And I will not spend time on lengthy introductions of our panelists, but noting that we have a remarkable reach in terms of both geography and the themes and topics covered. And without further ado, and also in the interest of having time to for questions towards the end, I would like to give the floor to the Minister for Environment, Climate and Energy of the Government of Iceland to provide us with opening remarks.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, one of the most repeated phrases in discussion about the Arctic is, what happens in the Arctic does not stay in the Arctic. What we mean is that changes in the Arctic will affect others. Indeed, it will affect all humanity. The Arctic is not a closed system in a part of the globe that most people see as a remote region. The Arctic is sounding a warning bell for the rest of the globe, as warming is 3 to 4 times faster in the high north than elsewhere. The opening of sea lanes across the North Pole can have profound changes. The melting of the Greenland ice cap will affect coastal areas everywhere, from the harbor outside this conference hall to Florida and Bangladesh. This is why the Arctic Circle Conference and forums attract not only partisans from the region, but a truly global audience. The Arctic is a key component of what scientists call the Earth cryosphere, the frozen realm of our planet. Antarctica, the vast ice continent, is another. Then we have the Third Pole, as many call the region, where the Himalayas and other massive mountain chains touch the sky at the heart of Asia. The name is apt. The Third Pole is home to thousands of glaciers and shows up often as a huge white spot in a satellite pictures of planet Earth. As the other poles, ice and permafrost is retreating. Like the Arctic, the region is home to remarkable cultures that have adapted to an environment considered hostile to many outsiders. And just like in the Arctic, what happens in the Third Pole does not stay in the Third Pole. The glaciers and snows in the Third Pole region feed some of the world's mightiest and most important rivers. Here we have water towers of Asia, which a large part of humanity depends on for drinking water, irrigation, food production, and other uses. Big natural changes in the Third Pole can have huge impacts directly on hundreds of millions of people. Indirectly, such changes will have a global impact. Why are we highlighting the Third Pole here at the Arctic Circle Assembly? In part, because we have much in common regarding the physical environment. The two regions have a fair share of ice and snow. Both are feeling acutely the impact of climate change. But then we have the human dimension. We who live in the two regions around the North Pole and on around the roof of Asia can learn from each other about the challenges we face and the solutions we must find. In the Arctic, the lines of communications have often been aligned north-south between center and periphery, rather than north-north, between people and communities in the region. This has changed. The Arctic discourse now takes place in various forums, in scientific bodies, in the Arctic Council, and here in the Arctic Circle, among other venues. It is richer and more inclusive than ever before. It has clearly helped to build bridges and to find solutions. Of course, we have a difficult time right now within the Arctic Council, but this is due to events outside the Arctic that have an impact on the Arctic, and indeed the global political discourse at the present time. I think the story of Arctic diplomacy and cooperation across borders has many lessons, including for the Third Pole process. Before the Arctic Council was established, we have set up scientific cooperation across borders to study and monitor changes in our region. This work produced some stellar outcomes. We received a groundbreaking report that alerted the world that certain pollutants were endangering mammals and humans in the Arctic, even if they were released half a world away. This helped to bolster support for international agreement to halt pollution. Then the Arctic Climate Impact Assessment arrived, one of the first big studies that showed that climate change was already here and was having a serious impact. This scientific collaboration paved the way for more general cooperation at a political level. I think the Arctic experience should be of interest for others, including the countries and other partners involved in the Third Pole process. We should and must continue to build bridges between science and policy, between business and governments and civil society, between nations, between regions. I am happy to see this session on the Third Pole here in Harpa today. And I wish all of us a fruitful discussion now and in the future. Thank you.
So, we now have a virtual speech from the Minister of Climate Change and Environment of the United Arab Emirates, Her Excellency Mariam Almheiri.
Excellencies, dear colleagues, it's a pleasure to address you from the United Arab Emirates, the home of the Third Pole process that aligns with our country's commitment to supporting global efforts to protect the natural world. You may know that the Third Pole region is an umbrella term for 10 Asian countries located in the geographic vicinity of the Himalaya. This includes two of the most populous nations in the world, China and India, five least developed countries, Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Nepal, and Myanmar, as well as Pakistan, Tajikistan, and Kyrgyzstan. The region got its name because its ice fields contain the largest reserve of fresh water outside the polar regions. It is the source of 10 major river systems that provide irrigation, power, and drinking water to over 1.9 billion people in Asia, over 24% of the world's population. Glacier melting due to climate change poses a serious threat to water security. If left unchecked, this phenomenon will trigger higher biodiversity loss, impede economic growth, lead to more acute food and water shortages, and even cause sea level rise thousands of kilometers away. To avoid this bleak future, the UAE has joined forces with the Arctic Circle to roll out the Third Pole process, a comprehensive effort to mitigate the threats to the region. I would like to take the opportunity to thank Arctic Circle and its chairman, His Excellency Olafur Ragnar Grimsson, for their productive collaboration and their unwavering dedication to tackling climate change in the polar regions. The Third Pole Process aims to bring together governments and scientists to strengthen the regional knowledge of the challenges of diminishing water resources. It represents an active engagement with governments and institutions to enhance scientific research and partnerships to inform policymaking. The whole process is guided by the Arctic experience of collaboration that we are all so familiar with, which enables effective communication of scientific information to policymakers specializing in addressing climate change. The process will be marked by milestone moments through a series of forthcoming Arctic Circle assemblies in Iceland and Arctic Circle forums. It seeks to make an instrumental contribution to the preparations for COP28 that we will host in the UAE in 2023. When we welcome the world to the UAE, we intend to ensure that the voice of every nation, whether developed or developing, and every stakeholder is heard, and that the specific geographic, climatic, and socioeconomic conditions of every region and country are considered when charting a global roadmap to a climate-resilient future. We are keen to promote a just and inclusive transition to a sustainable way of life that truly leaves no one behind. You might ask why a desert country like the UAE would be so interested in supporting a region that seems so diametrically opposite. The truth is, we have a long-standing collaboration with Arctic Circle, because what happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic, and the impacts of glacier melting extend far beyond the North Pole, South Pole, and Third Pole regions. So this is not about us and them, it's about all of us. I invite you all to visit the new section dedicated to the Third Pole process that you can find on the Arctic Circle website. This seeks to serve as a comprehensive information hub for the initiative, featuring reports, news, articles, interviews, video recordings, and podcasts. These can contribute to an improved understanding of the impacts of climate change on the Third Pole region, which, in turn, will strengthen the foundations for our collective efforts to address them. I'm confident that the Third Pole process will go a long way in forging meaningful partnerships and sharing experience to advance mitigation and adaptation action in the region. Thank you.
Next, we will have a video address from Dr. Pema Gyamtsho, who is now the Director General of ICIMOD, the regional organization in Kathmandu, formerly a politician in Bhutan and was Minister for Agriculture there for a number of years, a long-standing friend of Arctic Circle and the efforts to promote this dialogue.
Honorable Chair, distinguished speakers, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, greetings from Kathmandu, Nepal. On behalf of the International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, ICIMOD, and its 8 regional member countries, I would like to thank you for the importance that you attach to the issues that the Hindu Kush Himalayan region is facing, and regret that I am unable to join you in person this time. All of us know that the Third Pole encompasses the Tibetan Plateau and surrounding areas, including the Pamir Hindu Kush mountain ranges in the west, the Hengduan Mountains in the east, the Tinshan and Shulian Mountains in the north, and the Himalayas in the south. Hosting the world's highest peaks, unique cultures, rich and diverse flora and fauna, vast ice and snow reserves, and permafrost, the Third Pole Himalayan region is truly a global treasure trove. It feeds Asia's major rivers that sustain one of the world's most populated regions and supports an economy worth $4 trillion per year. Increasing global temperatures have disastrous impacts on the water resources of Asia. The Third Pole Himalayan region has been experiencing an unprecedented change over the last 2 decades, and the impacts are projected to worsen with time. Even a 1.5 degree centigrade rise is going to be too hot for the Hindu Kush Himalayan region, as it will increase the risk of species extinction, extreme weather events, flash floods, globes and avalanches, with far-reaching consequences for both human and environmental health in Asia and beyond. There is a dire need to recognize the third pole as the pulse of the planet. Improving our understanding of the changes in the third pole region is critical for the sustainability of natural systems and human societies in the area. Development and sharing of scientific information are therefore vital for increasing recognition of the need for international collaboration. The third pole process, based on our understanding from our previous engagement, is a comprehensive effort to introduce the Arctic model of collaboration to the third pole region. It builds on an action that has represented an active engagement with governments and institutions to strengthen scientific research and cooperation over the years. It will be a continued effort to define the challenge, initiate collaborative research, and identify effective way of information dissemination to facilitate informed deliberation and policy making for the third pole region. It will also help make essential preparations for the upcoming COP27 and COP28 meetings during this and the following year. ICIMOD, as a regional intergovernmental knowledge center, works for its 8 regional member countries that includes Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, China, India, Myanmar, Nepal, and Pakistan to help them to make the third pole region a safe, secure, and prosperous region by promoting a green, inclusive, and climate-resilient pathway. The center endeavors to co-create scientific knowledge, leading innovative solutions to complex socioeconomic and environmental issues, and fosters regional cooperation among its member countries through science policy dialogues such as this one. ICIMOD's Hindu Kush Himalayan Assessment Report 2019 and the following thematic assessments provide evidence to partners the need for linking science to policy and practice through increased regional and international cooperation. At ICIMOD, we are currently developing a short to medium-term investment framework, which we call the Mountains of Opportunity Investment Framework, to bring together policy engagement, strategic communication, capacity building, and finance to promote ambitious climate actions at the local, national, and regional scale in the Hindu Kush Himalayas. The overall vision of this framework is to contribute to increasing investments in the Hindu Kush Himalayas to address mountain-specific climate priorities and to support countries in meeting their climate and net zero targets, leading to green, resilient, and inclusive mountain development. I hope that the discussions that you will have at this session and the recommendations that will come out of it will help us in projecting the global importance of the Hindu Kush Himalayan region. We also hope that it will inspire scientists, experts, and policymakers from the Arctic region to share your experiences and lessons with us and build a platform for strengthening regional and international cooperation. Thank you.
I will now exercise my authority as the moderator to reverse the advertised order of the speakers and invite Professor Walter Immerzeel to give his presentation. Walter is arguably engaged in the most complete and encompassing research of water resources across the Hindu Kush Himalaya and the Third Pole region.
Thank you very much. First of all, I'd like to thank the Arctic Circle for inviting me to give a talk here about the research we have been doing on the Third Pole in the last 20 years. The Third Pole, as was said also by the previous speakers, is really a global hotspot of climate change impacts, vulnerability, and adaptation. If you see this map here, you can see that just below the mountain ranges, and this is not only the Himalaya, but also the Karakoram, the Pamir, the Chen Shan, the Tibetan Plateau is one of the most densely populated areas in the globe. So if you look at all the river basins in this region, it's about 25% of the global population lives in those basins and are in some way dependent on the water resources from those mountain ranges. The area is also characterized by huge climate contrast that goes from the dry mountain deserts on the Tibetan Plateau to one of the wettest places on Earth in the southeastern part of the region. We call it the third pole because the area contains the largest ice reserves beyond the polar regions. In total, there's about 100,000 square kilometers of glacier. The region is also inaccessible and characterized by complex geopolitics and is very vulnerable to climate change. In a study we did in 2019, we did an assessment of all the water towers, as we often call those mountain ranges in the world. And we tried to come up with a measure to quantify the importance of mountain ranges. So we looked both at the amount of water resources available in the mountains in the form of ice, snow, rain, or in surface water, but we also looked at the downstream use of those water resources. And we came up with this so-called water tower index. And from that analysis, it was very obvious that the third pole is by far the most important region globally in terms of the role that mountains have, in particular the Syrdarya, the Amudarya, the Indus, and the Ganges-Brahmaputra basin play an essential role in sustaining the lives of millions of people. But the third pole also warms faster than the global average. Here in the Arctic, we have the Arctic amplification, but in the mountains of the third pole, you have a phenomenon called elevation-dependent warming. So when, for example, all the climate models show this consistently, and when the, let's say, the global temperature rises by 1.5 degrees, this means on average an increase of 2.1 degrees on the third pole. And it's also not constant. So in the western part, we see higher warming rates than in the eastern part. And those processes behind that are very complex. But it's clear that it's warming faster than the rest of the globe. There's widespread evidence of climate change on the third pole. So, of course, glaciers are iconic for climate change. Here you see an example of the Rongbu Glacier on the north side of Mount Everest, picture taken by George Mallory, a famous explorer. Here you see exactly the same picture in 2007. And what you can see is that the changes in the landscape are dramatic, and the glacier has downwasted or thinned by over 100 meters, equal to the Dom Tower, which is from the city that I live in. When we zoom a bit out and look at the spatial patterns of glacier change, this is done by a satellite analysis, you can see that there's glacier thinning for almost all the glaciers in the region. So you can see, in particularly where you see the dark red dots, there is a strong thinning of the glaciers. On average, every glacier on the third pole thins every year by 30 centimeters over its entire surface. So that's a lot of water. There's also a small region where we actually see stable glaciers or glaciers that are gaining mass. And that is called, in scientific literature, we call that the Karakoram anomaly. And that anomaly is also possibly caused by human beings because there is widespread increases in irrigation in, for example, the Tarim Basin, but also in other parts of the area. That water is extracted from groundwater, that groundwater is evaporated by the crops, and that increases the atmospheric humidity. And based on regional climate simulations, that increased atmospheric humidity causes additional snow in those mountain ranges. And that favors, of course, glacier growth. So that's quite an interesting phenomenon. But overall, it's clear that the glaciers are losing mass in this region. When we look at the future, what you see here is a map of that shows the ice volume that remains by the end of the century if we continue on a path as we are currently doing. And you see that for most of the areas, in particularly on the southern arc of the Himalaya, we'll lose about, there will only be maybe 30, 40, 50% of the glacier ice left by the end of the century. Does this mean we will be running out of water? I don't think so, because due to climate change, we also have an acceleration of the hydrological cycle, and most climate models predict an increase in precipitation in this region. And in addition, the glaciers are there for quite a long time. Glaciers melt at faster rates, and they are slowly retreating, but there comes a point in time in the future when the absolute amount of meltwater from the glacier will start to diminish. And in this map, you can see the year when this will occur. So you see in most regions that occurs between 2030 and 2070, depending on the glacier characteristics. So there's going to be glacier meltwater for a long time. And in combination with increased precipitation, you see that the average water availability is going to increase in the future. However, that said, when you are the people who are really affected by those glacier changes are the people who live really in the mountains. And the communities dependent on glaciers and snow, they are feeling the impacts most strongly. Here you see an example of such a mountain community in India, which is exclusively depending on glacial meltwater. I think the key challenge that we have in the third pole is basically the disaster risk. This is increasing rapidly. Every year there is widespread evidence of floods, droughts, landslides, and glacial lake outburst floods. Many of those disasters are also transboundary in nature, and it requires close collaboration to adapt to that. And more than 1 million people are at risk of exposure to increasing frequency and intensity of natural hazards. Another interesting feature of the third pole is, I think, that the knife cuts on two ends. On the one hand, we have climate change that exacerbates natural hazards. On the other hand, we have an increased exposure. So more and more people move into the mountains, communities are expanding, and infrastructure is being constructed at a very rapid rate, and particularly hydropower. So that combination of increased natural hazards with an increase in exposure makes this into a very deadly cocktail, in my opinion. And there is widespread evidence. This is only of the last 2 years. In February 2021, a whole mountain collapsed in the Chamoli district in Uttarakhand. That caused a huge debris flow and flood wave, and it caused more than 200 people who died, and it destroyed a recently constructed hydropower dam. In the same year, in June, there were very strong monsoon rains quite early in the seasons in the Melanchi region in Nepal. That also caused a big debris flow and destroyed many houses lower in the valley. And very recently, of course, there has been exceptional flooding in Pakistan in August of this year, also for a large part due to very abnormal rainfall in the mountainous parts of Pakistan. So I'd like to finish by summarizing the four key risks in mountain ranges, which are also very much true for the third pole. So this comes from the recently published IPCC assessment report, and they've written a special chapter on mountains, a cross-chapter paper, and four key risks are identified. So the loss of lives, harm to people, and damages to infrastructure from hazards, such as landslides and floods. Secondly, there's changes in water availability, and that can impact livelihoods, but also economic sectors, both in the mountains and in the lowlands. Mountains are also hotspots of biodiversity. Changes to this very sensitive ecosystem also causes a risk of species extinction. And finally, intentional losses and harm to people and losses of cultural values from the decline of ice, snow cover, and warming, as well as the increase in disasters. So, I think it's really time we come into action. In the last decade, I think the scientific progress in this region has been tremendous, and we know really a lot of things now, and we know enough to take action. But better data, better knowledge, communication, and cooperation will also mean better action. So we need large-scale investments with regional cooperation, but we also need bottom-up investments with local and national cooperation. So I think the third pole process initiated by the Arctic Circle provides grand opportunities to put third pole climate change issues high on the political and scientific agendas. Thank you very much.
We now welcome to the podium Dr. Ravichandran, who is the General Secretary in the Ministry for Earth Sciences in the Government of India. And Ravichandran has been very much involved in efforts to initiate and facilitate collaboration in the region in recent years.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and very good afternoon to all of you. Of course, the day before yesterday, I was talking about the North Pole and its impact on the India and the Indian Ocean. Now I will be little bit touch upon not only North Pole, the third pole also play a major role, not only in India, Indian Ocean, and the Bay of Bengal regions as a total. As it is already pointed out, the Himalaya, it is critical for life, economy, energy needs of Asia. And you all know that it is about 1.9 billion people living around this water tower, and it is play a vital role not only for the water, but also weather and climate, most importantly, Indian monsoon or Asian monsoon system. And it is also prone to natural hazards and extreme events, such as earthquake, landslides, cloud burst, glacial lake glow, and et cetera. I think this is the one reason, one place where you have a geophysics, as well as cryosphere, atmosphere, and all the things play a vital role here. Of course, in the recent years, the deterioration of Himalayan ecology over time can have a serious impact on the human life security. The Himalayan system is already experiencing large changes due to the global warming and will significantly affect the local in the Himalayan region, but also the Bay of Bengal and its ecosystem, depend on the large country around the Bay of Bengal. So considering the importance of the Himalayan region, of course, Dr. Walter was mentioning about the water tower, how much volume is available, how much area is the glaciers is there. But actually the ground reality is we don't have the proper data in that region. And all the things are, most of the things are modeling effort, but we don't have a proper ground truth data. So considering the importance of the data, so we initiated the HICOM project. It is basically Himalayan cryospheric observation and modeling. Of course, the Ministry of Earth Sciences, Government of India, is coordinating with the various institutions in India. It is a multi-institutional project to understand the process, what is going on, and its impact in further. Of course, there are many institutions involved in the monitoring of a Himalayan cryosphere perspective. There are many institutions in India is involved, and also hydrology and water budget of Himalayan rivers, and also monsoon and climate change studies, and also geo hazard studies, such as the recent episode of Chumoli. When we talk about the Himalaya and also the adjoining things, the Bay of Bengal, it is basically it is a symbiotic relation between Himalaya and Bay of Bengal. The ecosystem of the Bay of Bengal largely depend on the Himalayan rivers and draining to the Bay of Bengal, because the fluvial flux to the Bay of Bengal is very important from the nutrients from the Himalayan region. The Bengal fan, it is the world's biggest fan, and it is formed mainly by the erosion of Himalayan rivers and extends right up to the Sri Lanka, thus having importance of, for the entire Bay of Bengal region and the countries bordering it. So the Himalayan system is already experiencing large changes due to global warming, and it will significantly affect the Bay of Bengal, its fisheries, and humanity around it. The Himalayan mountain system lies beyond the sovereign control of one nation and imbibes in its fold a multitude of scientific phenomena, issues that are common to all the Himalayan nations as well as neighboring states in the Bay of Bengal. The linkages and exchanges between the people of the Bay of Bengal region for cultural, social, religious, and commercial reasons have existed since a long time. It is critically important to monitor the earth system process that have pronounced effect on Himalayan system and its impact on the Bay of Bengal by establishing a permanent intergovernmental scientific forum under BIMSTEC, that is a Himalayan Science Council, which we are in the process of establishing. So the BIMSTEC Himalayan Science Council, it is a basically a Bay of Bengal initiative for multi-sector technical and economic cooperation, contains about six countries, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and Thailand. It is basically in the Bay of Bengal around it regions. The primary objective of the council is to engage scientific activities to develop a sustainable development plan by keeping regional geographical factors in mind and evolve people-friendly norms by consensus. The collaborative project selected should be the regional or the global in character or nature. The scope of the scientific activities and cooperation will broadly cover various areas such as the cryosphere, monsoon, oceanography, and many other things, including social elements. With this, the challenges, what are the challenges and way forward is, of course, the Himalayan region consistently warming more than global average, already mentioned, and glaciers and permanent snows are melting rapidly in the recent years, and also shrinking and melting of glaciers and formation and expansion of glacial lakes are increasing, and increased risk and hazard. It is also GLOF is a serious problem in that area. So we need to have an enhanced monitoring network, and we need to have a, what is the volume of water in the third pole is, it is not known. So we need to quantify the depth of the glaciers, of depth of the water volume is available. I think that it is important to know. So what are the total water volume is available so that we can sustainably utilize for the entire region around the Himalaya. Of course, we need to strengthen the capacity building. And also, finally, we need to have a regional collaboration and data and information exchange in that region. With this, thank you very much once again. Thank you.
Well, it's already 2:05, so we conclude like completely on the last minute, like a train in Switzerland, as I sometimes put it. So we really don't have time for a dialogue, I'm afraid. But I'm tempted though to invite one question from the audience, if we can ask one quick question, and then we have to give the floor to the next session. Yeah, please. So.
Yes, Dagfinnur and colleagues. My name is Rasmus Bertelsen from Aqualady in Tromsø. This is an incredibly laudable project because, as you talked about, these are some of the world's most populous nations, but these are also nations that have very severe conflicts between them. India, Pakistan, China, India. So my question is very simply, what are you going to do to insulate this cooperation from other conflicts in the area? How are you going to avoid that other conflicts between these participating nations will affect this cooperation? Thank you.
Well, I'm tempted to provide you with an answer, but we've discussed this before. But if I may direct this question to Dr. Ravichandran, who has been involved in this and in efforts in the region to set up collaborations.
Yeah, basically we don't look at the conflict. Basically, we don't know what is happening there. So for that, we need to understand more and more in that region. For that, the science is the vehicle, and that is a backbone to work around that area and try to collaborate in that sense so that we can try to avoid any other conflict. So if we know more and more, I think it will be, things will be clear, so that can be avoided any other conflict or anything. That's what I feel.
Yeah, and if I may give a quick comment, provide a big quick comment on this. I mean, the problem is not to isolate this project from conflicts in the region. The very nature of the process itself it's an engagement with issues that are taking place in regions of conflict and can contribute to dialogue where it does not exist. And the imperative nature of the need for data sharing means that it's the process is an engagement with difficult issues and the point of it is precisely not to isolate it from other difficult issues. So it's a process. It does not have an end goal written in stone. But so this is not my role, really, to answer the questions. But I'm afraid we are out of time. So we need to give the stage to the next session.